Good evening. We have a small but a distinguished gathering. We also have a distinguished speaker and a distinguished discussion, and I hope we will have a distinguished discussion later. I am privileged to steer this meeting as a member of the Gamani Korea Foundation. The chairman is here, Dr. Nima Sandaratna. Dr. Dushni Virakoni is also a member of the board. And Professor Tilak Abeysinghe is the director of research of the Gamani Korea Foundation. And so we have a very good gathering. Without much ado, I feel that all of you have got this brief CV of Professor Abeysinghe, and I don't think I need to read the whole thing, but let me just remind you that Professor Abeysinghe is the research director of the Gamani Korea Foundation, and prior to joining the Gamani Korea Foundation in July 2017, he was a professor of economics at the National University of Singapore. He was also a visiting professor at Kyoto University and Peradeniya University in Sri Lanka. He continues his affiliation with the National University of Singapore, both with the Department of Economics and the Asia Competitiveness Institute at the Lee Kuan Yew School. Okay, over to you, Professor.
I hope this is working. Yep. Thanks, Lloyd. And also, I want to thank Nimal, Dr. Nimal Sandaratna, for taking this initiative, and the board of directors of the Gamani Korea Foundation for inviting me to give this talk. I told a friend of mine a couple of days ago about this talk. My friend asked, "Are you talking in Sinhala?" I said, "No, then no point." English-speaking audience already knows the story, so you have to tell the story in Sinhala. So I, kept that point in mind that I had to do this in Sinhala as well. I went to Singapore 30 years ago. When I went there, public buses in Singapore were still largely non-air-conditioned. My friend Sudhat is here. He was my contemporary. In Singapore, he knows. Also look old buses. And public toilets were still smelly. Good test of development of a country, how smelly the toilets are. And I was even able to get away with a couple of parking charges just by talking to the police. I thought Singapore is still a developing country. But I had the good fortune of seeing with my own eyes this spectacular transformation of Singapore over the years. Just the way National University of Singapore transformed is quite remarkable. When I first joined, it was just a teaching university. My colleagues in the department, when they got together in the the common room, what did they talk? Did they talk research? No. They were just monitoring the stock market. Nothing else. Now, NUS, a leading top-rank research university. Just remarkable. So, in my presentation, I will give a quick overview of the Singapore economy first. That sort of sets the background. And then highlight some of the lessons. There are a lot of lessons that we can learn, but I thought few points are more relevant to Sri Lanka than others. And then also highlight some of the problems Singapore is currently facing. Now, in this graph, I have put four countries: Singapore, Japan, Sri Lanka, and Switzerland. And I chose Switzerland. So this is the per capita GDP in purchasing power parity term. There are non-economists here, so purchasing parity numbers are internationally comparable. Now, I put Switzerland in this graph because for Singapore, Switzerland was a role model, and also had a target of reaching Swiss per capita income at a certain year, but Singapore surpassed that much more quickly. What's very interesting about this graph is look at Japan and Sri Lanka per capita income in the 1950s. Very similar. Look at per capita income of Sri Lanka and Singapore in the 1960s, early 60s. Very similar. Then see the departure. Sri Lanka completely stagnated all the way until about mid-1980s. See? And then some pickup occurs despite the wars going on. A substantial pickup occurs only after about mid-2000s. Sometimes, you know, one may argue, Singapore was so successful because it's a small place, easy to manage. Is it the story? I thought of looking into some numbers. How do we measure the size of the country, either in terms of population size or in terms of land area? So I thought to pick some few countries in red here that have population size similar to Singapore. They are outside Western Europe, but relatively doing well. And if you look at the per capita GDP, Singapore is far ahead of them. And look at their land area. They are much bigger than Singapore. Though the population size is similar, much bigger than Singapore. Look at Nicaragua. Land area is so big, but per capita income so low. So if you go by the land area, Singapore is a small place, only currently it's 719 square kilometers. I picked up two economies that are doing relatively well, Dominica and Seychelles. Their per capita income is also much lower than Singapore. Therefore, we cannot say that Singapore succeeded just because of small size. This is another graph. Now, this one shows the lifetime labor income of Singapore household in the 20th income percentile, lowest quintile. Now, this is lifetime income. So I got the data from the Department of Statistics of the Government of Singapore, unpublished data, household labor income by age and year. So if you put this data into a table, age, year, go down the diagonal, you can trace the same birth cohort. That way you can construct the age income profile of the same household over their working years. And then convert those numbers into a present value, so that is the lifetime income. And on the horizontal axis is the year of birth. Now, Singapore became independent, or self-governance, came to Singapore in 1959, became independent in 1965. Until then, this lowest income quintile, during the colonial period, their income has stagnated. If anything, has gone down. Only after independence, it goes up. Again, independent Singapore must have done something right. Now, if you look at some other development indicators, Sri Lanka in parentheses in red, 1965 because that's the year Singapore became independent. Now, in terms of infant mortality, if you are looking for a single indicator of a development of a country, infant mortality rate is the one because it reflects on the one side mother's health, on the other side the healthcare system. Singapore was somewhat ahead of Sri Lanka in 1965. Now Singapore has one of the lowest infant mortality rates in the world. Actually, Sri Lanka has done quite remarkably well in that regard. 8.6 is among the low numbers. Life expectancy at birth, Singapore was little ahead, still ahead here, but again, Sri Lanka has done well on this count. Public home ownership. Now, in Singapore, a lot of people are living in high-rise buildings. They are called public housing. A lot of people who don't live in Singapore don't understand the meaning of public housing. In Hong Kong, public housing means government-owned, people renting them from the government. Whereas in Singapore, they are publicly provided, privately-owned houses, apartments. Now more than 80% of the people live in those kind of houses. Now, in Sri Lanka, of course, there's no issue here. It's all very much private housing. So just to compare the numbers. Now, labor force with tertiary education. For Sri Lanka, I was able to find only with GCE A-level and above. Usually, we don't put GCE A-level in the tertiary category. But these are the numbers. In 1965, only about 2% had tertiary education. Now, it's about 53% in Singapore. Sri Lanka still lagging behind, only about 20%. Labor force with university degree, look at here, is about 34%. I'll show a graph later. Sri Lanka is still far behind. Of course, this doesn't suggest that Sri Lanka should expand the university degrees. In Singapore, it expanded because the economy expanded. Some books, just in case you want to read. So I recommend 13 and 14, they are my own. 13 is not readable, it's an econometrics text on Singapore. 14 is quite readable. This the Far East and Australasia. This is an encyclopedic volume. So I was invited to write the Singapore chapter, economy, Singapore economy. So I did this for a number of years, then passed it on to a colleague of mine. Other notable readings, Lee Kuan Yew, Singapore's founding prime minister. I think quite a lot of you have read this book, From Third World to First, The Singapore Story, quite fascinating thing to read, book to read. Then in 2011, Lee Kuan Yew published another book called Hard Truths to Keep Singapore Going. This was a big concern Lee Kuan Yew always had, that younger Singaporeans who have grown up in comfort take things for granted. They forget the struggle the forefathers had to go through. Therefore, this book is basically a reminder to the younger generation, you know, don't take things for granted. Singapore is very vulnerable. Goh Keng Swee, The Practice of Economic Growth. He was the first finance minister of Lee Kuan Yew cabinet and also the economic architect. I talk a little bit more about him. When I read this book, it's so insightful. Just to give you some background information on Singapore, self-governance in 1959 from British. Then Lee Kuan Yew worked very hard to form the Malaysian Federation with Malaysia, Singapore, North Borneo, and Sarawak. Now, but a lot of incompatibilities. Singapore is of course dominated by Chinese, Malaysia by Malays, and Singapore was promoting meritocracy. Malaysia wanted to support the Malays called Bumiputras. So these incompatibilities were mounting. So the then Prime Minister of Malaysia, Tunku Abdul Rahman, called Lee Kuan Yew to office and said, get out. So basically Singapore was kicked out. So when that happened, this is a very famous picture of Lee Kuan Yew. So he called a press conference to break the news to the public, because he came to power with a lot of promise. Oh, we joined the Malaysia, therefore we have no problem, we can survive. Now he has to tell, we are on our own. Lee Kuan is a very stern person, I mean, no nonsense, you know, I hardly see, you know. But here, the emotions are really genuine. Actually, he had to stop the press conference for a moment and went away and came back. He could not control his emotions because now we are on our own. That's what he wanted to say. So Singapore became independent not by choice, you know, but the circumstances were such that. Now land area has grown. So here in Sri Lanka, the land area is shrinking, I guess. When government starts projects like underground train system or underground highway systems, at the same time start filling up the sea. So that's how the land has expanded. Population size currently is about 5.6 million people, and the resident population, that includes Singaporeans and permanent residents, about 3.96, about 4 million. Population density is not that bad, actually, if you compare with Hong Kong or Tokyo, it's not that bad. I looked at Sri Lanka numbers in Colombo, it's way lower, some 3,000 plus per square kilometer. Political system is a democratic system. PAP, People's Action Party. Party ruled since 1959. Cabinet is highly professional. I talk about this later. Economic system, they call it market-driven guided economy. It's not 100% market. It's guided. If you want to get a glimpse of Singapore's history, this YouTube clip is very, very nice, actually. It shows how Singapore basically started. It was Stamford Raffles. Just to give you a brief account of that, British were looking for a foothold in that part of the region because Dutch were controlling it. So East India Company sent Stamford Raffles to look for a place. So he came to Singapore. At that time, Singapore was under the under Johor Sultanate. Johor is the neighboring state of Malaysia, under Sultanate. So he conspired with the brother of the guy through a conspiracy. Raffles acquired Singapore. So it's a typical British tactic. And then he left Singapore in the hands of his friend, Farquhar. And Raffles went to Bengkulan, Indonesia. He came back after 3 or 4 years. Then population size in Singapore had grown so much, a lot of migration from China, India, and Malaysia. And they were living all together. Raffles didn't like it. So Raffles did a segregation which exists till today. Malays are here, Chinese are there, Indians are there, British are here in the center. You know, divide and rule. Now, after Lee Kuan Yew passed away, I wrote a piece in the Daily News, Lessons from Lee Kuan Yew. So I hope it is still there. Development experience at independence. So Singapore still had this village setting at that time. Although the center was highly urban, still the village setting was there. And in Malay, there's a Malay word for this. They call it kampong. Kampong. And still there is one island in Singapore that still has this village setting. They keep it preserved. When you go to Singapore, you can pay a visit there. You can rent a bike and go around. And at the time of independence, there was massive unemployment, low-skilled workforce, no industrial entrepreneurs, only commercial. Because Singapore started as a re-export economy, export economy. Therefore, there were commercial entrepreneurs, but no industrial entrepreneurs. No domestic savings, wretched housing conditions are said to be very, very bad, militant labor unions, strikes, racial riots between Chinese and Malays, bombing, I talk about this later, there were bombing as well in Singapore, and Stinky River. This is a picture of Singapore River at that time. Now, if you go there, you see it's a very clean river. This is one of the things that Lee Kuan Yew wanted to do, take a stroll by the river and see if there is any dirt in the river. So immediately call the people in charge, clean it up. It took many years. Even when I went there, still they were cleaning the river. If you look at the development experience, some strategic plans, Singapore did not have any regular five-year plans, but they call a committee. Of course, the first one, so visionary plan, so the things that Singapore put in place are still going on under this plan. Number of institutions were set up under this plan, they are still going on. But subsequently, in response to a crisis, government set up a committee, the committee goes on consulting people and then come up with recommendations. These last two, even, we provided inputs to these two. Development strategy. When I look at Singapore's development strategy, I can think of two. One is historical continuity and branching off. Now, after independence, Singapore did not want to cut off the British style of the economy. They just continued, but moved on to other areas. Now, Singapore was a re-export economy to start with. In absolute numbers, it has grown up so much. But what has happened is the share in total exports has gone down. Re-export share in total exports has gone down. Now we have manufacturing exports moving on to service. Now, here the thrust of the Singapore government now invests a lot of money on research and development to come up with own innovations. Global schoolhouse, Singapore wants to be a center for schooling and university studies, medical hub to attract a lot of medical tourists to Singapore, 2 casinos. This is something, again, Lee Kuan Yew resisted a lot. But he had to, because Lee Kuan Yew said, in his own words, he said, Chinese are congenital gamblers. Therefore, he didn't like the idea. But finally, he had to give in because running out of choices. And there is a regionalization drive to invest in other countries and reap on first move advantage. So this is one thing Singapore is doing. Now, after the independence, you know, Singapore is still doing what traditionally we do, like textile exports and all that, then took a chance and moved into electronics. It paid off very well. Then the competition started to increase, took a chance, and put money into bioengineering side, biomedical engineering side. It's a very high value-added, low-employing sector, but now the benefits are coming in. So when competition is coming in, they may consider something else. I'm not going to spend much time on this. Some major institutions, this Economic Development Board was set up in 1961. It's the very important institution there to attract foreign direct investment, develop local entrepreneurship, and promote Singapore's investment abroad. All these are done. And Urban Redevelopment Authority, Singapore acquired a lot of land from the people. You know, at independence, I think it was 44% was government-owned. Now it is about 85% government-owned. It's acquired. Now, National Wages Council, this is a very important institution in Singapore. In the past, it was very, very important. Now it's somewhat less. But still, it's a tripartite entity. Government, employers, and trade unions get together. And they study the productivity trends and make recommendations for wages for the next year. A lot of companies, government, private sector, they follow these wage guidelines. It plays a very, very important role. Central Provident Fund, this is the compulsory, mandatory savings scheme. Even self-employed have to put money in there. That's why it's called Central Provident Fund instead of Employee Provident Fund. And you can take the money at the retirement, 55, but still you have to put some money in an account called retirement account. You can't take it out. You have to convert that into an annuity. So effectively, you can't take that money out. So therefore, people call CPF cash prior to funeral. Fiscal policy, this is quite interesting. Government tries to keep government expenditure, you know, as low as possible, about 15% of GDP. Of course, Singapore's GDP has grown up so much, therefore 15% is still a lot. So if you look at OECD countries, more than 40% is government expenditure. So you see the difference. On the revenue side, there is something very, very interesting here. Item number one, investment returns from reserves. Singapore has been accumulating a lot of foreign reserves. So some Singaporeans complain, why accumulate so much foreign reserves? When is the rainy day going to come? Spend it. You know, now, a few years ago, government decided use up to 50% of the interest earnings, investment earnings of foreign reserves for budgetary purposes. Now, in 2016, it contributed the highest to the government revenue. So you don't have to increase taxes. No need to increase taxes, income taxes. Without this item, corporate income tax was the highest, still the second highest. So I looked into Sri Lankan data. In Sri Lanka, corporate income tax is less than 10%. So low. I can think of two. I'm not an expert of Sri Lankan economy yet. I can think of two reasons. One is, of course, the Sri Lanka's private sector is still too small. Second reason, perhaps the biggest, is tax avoidance. Tax avoidance. So if this loophole can be fixed, corporate income tax, you know, can generate enough government revenue. Now, goods and services tax is just like our VAT. It's a consumption-based tax. In general, these consumption-based taxes are regressive. Regressive means poor people spend a larger proportion of their income on these taxes. So there are tax rebates given to poor people. Personal income tax is next, and there are a lot of other things. Among them is the vehicle quota system. To control vehicle population, there is a huge tax on vehicles. Budget surplus, there's a recurrent budget surplus. No external debt since mid-1990s. Domestic public debt is a misnomer. So I wanted to highlight this because if you look at Singapore's public debt as a percentage of GDP, it's more than 100%. If you don't know the inside story, you may think, oh my goodness, there is so much public debt in Singapore. But it's a contradiction. Budget surplus on the one hand, there is public debt on the other. It can't be. Actually, what's happening here, Singapore has a thriving stock market, but no bond market. So the government purposely wants to develop the bond market. So government issues government bonds, both short-term and long-term. And it's mandatory that the companies and statutory boards have to keep a certain portion of their portfolio in terms of bonds. That's why there is debt. If you look at the net debt, it means gross debt minus of the assets, Singapore has no debt problem at all. Monetary policy, central bank is called Monetary Authority of Singapore, and more than 2,500 financial institutions rank among the top 10 most sophisticated financial centers. Money supply is endogenous. Interest rate is determined by world market. Only Monetary Policy Singapore has is an exchange rate policy to control imported inflation. Structural change, I just for the sake of interest, I thought of putting this graph. So there are planned structural changes. Then there are unplanned structural changes resulting from crises. Now this is Singapore's GDP in log terms, and the red line is the actual GDP. So first recession occurred in 1985-86, that period. Until then, GDP was growing on a straight line. If you extend this straight line, this is where Singapore should have been, but it never went back to that line. This is the same, this is same for every country. Same for every country. Why this is important? Because in economics, people, you know, the traditional business cycle theory, you put a straight line through, you put a straight line through, and deviation from that straight line are taken as transitory business cycles. So come up with fiscal policies, monetary policies to fix them. But actually, it is not the case. Once you're thrown out of the train, you never go back. So there was Asian financial crisis, thrown out again. There was IT bust and SARS, thrown out again. Global financial crisis, thrown out again. So during these periods, growth came back. That's the slope of the line remained the same, but the level shift, you know, never went back. Okay, that's basically a very, very quick background to Singapore. Lessons from Singapore. Now, two key figures I want to highlight here. This is Lee Kuan Yew. This is Goh Keng Swee. Very bright chaps. Lee Kuan Yew got a first class in law. They call double star first class in law from Cambridge University. Actually, in his memoirs, he said in his school, you know, in Singapore's Raffles Institute, he did not come top. He came the second. Top was a girl. Then he said, I did the next best thing I could do, to marry her. And Goh Keng Swee got a PhD in economics from London School of Economics. Now, both died at the age of 92, and Goh Keng Swee was about 5 years older than Lee Kuan Yew. So at the funeral of Goh Keng Swee, Lee Kuan Yew said, Goh Keng Swee was the man of ideas, I was the implementer. So that's why I purposely picked these two photos to highlight that. See, the iron-fisted man, you know, implement policies with determination, is a man of ideas. So Lee Kuan Yew said, work on the political equation carefully first. This is nothing new to Sri Lankans, but I'll tell you, you know, a bit later, you know, economists have got it all wrong. So that's why I thought to highlight it. Here's Goh Keng Swee coming back with a PhD in economics from London School of Economics. Work on the Singapore economy. Based on his experience, this is what he's telling. Our experience confirms some of the conventional wisdom of growth theory, but refutes much of the rest. The role of government is pivotal. Non-economic factors, which have yet to be reduced to a coherent multidisciplinary system, are more important than economic variables. When I read this, my God, this is it. You know, this is it. Because of our economic training, we don't think this way. You have to be a practical man to think this way. Non-economic factors matter more. In economics, we talk about basic factors of production. What? Capital, labor, technology, are they really the basic factors of production? Actually, they are intermediate. Basic factors of production are non-economic. As Gokengsui said here, economists have not yet, even today, this was in 1960s, even today, economists haven't worked this out. So after the global financial crisis, I was invited by Professor Nouriel Roubini to write a piece to his blog, Economonitor. So I wrote this: private vice to public virtue, re-examine the basic economic dictum. So economists talk about micro foundation of macroeconomics. I suggested we should talk about macro foundation of microeconomics. What we take for granted matters a lot. You know, so economists, you know, they talk about utility maximizing individuals, profit maximizing firms. They all have to operate in a macro environment, which we can't take for granted. So that's the basic point here. Now, the role of the government, emphasized by two Nobel laureates, Amartya Sen and Michael Spence. Amartya Sen came to Singapore. I went to listen to his speech. So at that time, Chicago School of Economics was very prominent, and they were advocating less government. Government is bad, less government. So that's the front on which Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan came to power. But here Amartya Sen saying, government's role is very important. Now Michael Spence, he was the chair of a very high-profile committee. They studied successful stories in the world. They also came up with the same conclusion, the role of the government. To Sri Lankans, this is nothing new. We know exactly what's going on here in Sri Lanka. But to economists, it is not very obvious. So the government's development ideology has been growth-driven, purely pragmatic, and adaptable to changing circumstances. As I said earlier, market-driven guided economy. It's a very pragmatic approach. Now, as I said, there are a lot of non-economic factors, but I can think of four factors that are very relevant to Sri Lanka. These are the four factors: political stability and quality of governance, national security, politicians with high opportunity cost, and geopolitics. ASEAN is the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. I'll talk about each of these in detail. Political stability and quality of governance. Now, Lee Kuan Yew, as you know, is a very strong leader supported by a committed team. He stayed in power as prime minister for 31 years. And then he worked out a successor, stepped down at the peak of his popularity, and gave the chair to Goh Chok Tong. And he created a post for himself called senior minister, still stayed in the cabinet. Then when Goh Chok Tong stepped down, Lee Kuan Yew's son, the current prime minister, Lee Hsien Loong, became the prime minister. Then Lee Kuan Yew became the minister mentor, still stayed in power for another 21 years. So as you can see, a strong man, you know, wielding the power for a long time. He popularized the idea of Asian values, community before self. Duties over rights. So this duties over right is nothing alien to Asians. Here we talk about parents' duties towards children, children's duties towards parents. We don't talk about rights, do we? In Asia, we don't talk about rights, you know, children's rights, parents' rights, human rights, you know, it's something with Western concept. His advice to cabinet: under promise, deliver more. We see the opposite here in Sri Lanka. Now, at that time, Lee Kuan Yew was a very dictatorial figure, you know, crushed opponents. So Western media criticized him a lot. But he did not stay quiet. He took them to court. There's a long list of Western magazines, you know, journals, Time Magazine, the Financial Times, International Herald Tribune, Far Eastern Economic Review, they all lost. Paid huge sums to Lee Kuan Yew and his ministers. The last I remember was Bloomberg. Bloomberg went for an out-of-court settlement because it went through a court case, they had to pay more. So Lee Kuan Yew was sending a message. You have the freedom of speech, but get your facts right. I wish this happens in Sri Lanka. Then people stop, making allegations without having facts in their hands. Currently, you know the story, Anything that comes to their mouth, they will say that. That's very, very unhealthy. But Western media didn't like it. They call him tin pot tyrant. Tin pot because Singapore is such a small place, dictator. But later on, Singapore developed, Lee Kuan Yew became an inspiration to the world. Political stability is needed for the economy to take off. Quality of governance to maintain the altitude. Political stability is an exogenous variable. Quality of governance is an endogenous variable. So exogenous variable means it has to be provided. Endogenous means it emerges through the kind of system we have in place. Change in party politics versus single party rule. Now, this American economist described this in a beautiful way. Roving bandit versus stationary bandit. Sometimes we have to choose between these two bad guys. Which one do we choose? If you have seen the Japanese movie Seven Samurai, you know what roving bandit is. Farmers work very hard. During the harvest time, bandits come, plunder the harvest, run away. Run away because they are worried about getting caught. Change in party politics is like that. The vision is only for 5 years. They are worried that the voters may vote them out. Therefore, if they want to plunder, they will plunder. And so stationary bandit is a guy, still a bandit, still plunders, but stay in one place and does that. Good example, I hope I'm not taken to a court for this, Suharto, Indonesia. People allege he was very corrupt, but he was in power for 32 years, country developed. Because stationary bandit has the incentive to make the pie bigger so that he get a bigger portion. So it's better to have a stationary bandit than a roving bandit. When Indonesia, threw away Suharto, it went down a spiral. You all know the story now. So changing party politics versus single party rule. If you look at East Asian countries, single party rule for a long time. Japan, even single man for a long time. Taiwan, a single man for a long time. Malaysia, a single man for a long time. Hong Kong, of course, under British. So, political stability, suggestion is either a single party rule for a sustained period. If you look at Singapore's story, you don't have to have that for very long. I think 15 years, a determined government can take the economy off the ground. Or a common agreement on an economic agenda is needed to set the vision beyond a single political term. Focus on the long run, not on what is politically expedient. So when I saw the unity government was formed in Sri Lanka, I was hopeful that they can come up with an agenda that cannot be changed without 2/3 majority in the parliament, so that they will stick to this agenda, regardless who is in power. Unfortunately, it didn't happen. Quality of governance. Political stability does not guarantee quality of governance. Quality of governance emerges through the type of economic and political system in place. Now, if you look at, dictators, they provide political stability, but have they succeeded? No. So there is another mechanism that has to be in place. One mechanism that seems to work, you may disagree, that seems to work, private sector-driven open economy is one mechanism that acts as a disciplining force on government bureaucracy. Look at China and India. Formidable bureaucracies in the world. But when China started opening up since 1978, see, economy prospering. India started under Manmohan Singh, started opening up in mid-1990s. you know, bureaucracy is getting disciplined. Still bureaucracy is there, it is getting disciplined. So one mechanism that seems to work is this private sector driven open economy, open to both international trade and investment. So that sort of a check and balance on, if you take Lee Kuan Yew, he was effectively a dictator, but he could not act as a dictator because of this another condition that was essential for Singapore's survival. So what I did was with a student of mine, PhD student of mine from Colombo University here, and we were quite interested in looking into Malaysia and Sri Lanka because of this ethnic strife. Malaysia has majority Malays, and Chinese are the minority, major minority group, and Sri Lanka has Sinhalese, the majority group, and the largest minority is Tamils. But Sri Lanka, both countries adopted ethnic preference policies, but Malaysian policies were more extreme than Sri Lankan policies. But Sri Lanka failed. Malaysia continued, thrived. So we were keen on this. So we did a study and basically checked. We wanted to see how openness affects growth, quality of governance, and ethnic probability of ethnic conflict. Now, quality of governance, we measure in terms of a proxy variable, corruption. But it's a proxy because not having corruption does not necessarily mean high quality government. Corruption, low corruption is a necessary condition, but it's not sufficient. And we also had another variable in this model called ethno-linguistic fractionalization, how divided the country is in terms of ethnic. I'm not going to go through the results of this exercise. So we used a panel regression and estimated this equation to see how their effect is. As for the openness, we use two measures. One is the standard measure of trade to GDP ratio, and another measure we borrowed from others is the regulatory framework. Because on the trade to GDP ratio, US is a closed economy, because its trade to GDP ratio is lower than that of, say, Malaysia. But that doesn't mean it's a closed economy. Some results from this exercise: trade openness enhances growth, improves quality of governance, lowers the probability of ethnic conflicts, regardless of democracy or authoritarian. That's the key point. Now, openness to investment may reinforce this effect. What's happening here? Openness exerts a disciplining effect on the regime. That's what's happening, disciplinary effect. Some other results from the exercise: on the vertical axis, the probability of ethnic conflict; on the horizontal axis, democracy index. If the index value is zero, it is a dictatorial system or autocracy. If the index value is high, it's a full-fledged democracy. A full-fledged democracy is where institutional structure works well regardless of which party is in power. In the middle are fragile democracies. So I put Sri Lanka in that category, unfortunately. You know, though we talk a lot about democracy, we are in the middle. So what this, and this graph is only suggestive, so don't take it virtually. It's only suggestive coming out of this model. What it says is that either an authoritarian system or a full-fledged democracy, the probability of an ethnic conflict is low. In a fragile democracy, it is much higher. That's what is coming out of it. Similar graph here. Ethnic homogeneity or large heterogeneity is good for ethnic peace. On the horizontal axis is the ethno-linguistic fractionalization. Number zero means homogeneous society. One means highly heterogeneous society. Again, in the middle, you know, is mixed. So countries like Japan, you know, highly homogeneous, you know, probability of ethnic conflict is low. Australia is moving in this direction, you know, one major group and a lot of minorities, so the probability of ethnic conflict is low. Whereas countries like Sri Lanka, Malaysia, you know, with large one minority, the probability of ethnic conflict is higher. Okay, so that's basically on, you know, political stability and quality of governance. National security. So this graph shows Singapore's expenditure as a percent of GDP on social spending and national security, defense spending. Roughly similar amounts. This is again something Singaporeans have been critical about. You know, since independence, it has been pretty much peace. You know, no conflicts. Why spend so much on military? You know, why spend so much on defense? That's the criticism. But Singapore continue to spend a lot, upgrade the army all the time, you know, upgrade the air force, you know, they have regular exercises, simulated exercises that keep on going on. Singapore has a very highly sophisticated army right now. Now, when you look at it, why it is needed? Because threats are not necessarily external. Quite often it is internal. When you look at the world, most of the time the problems are internally created than externally created. So, also Singapore had this strict handling of race and religious extremism. You know, recently some church pastors were made to apologize because they made some derogatory remarks on Buddhists and Taoists. So, Singapore's a small boat. If few monkeys jump here and there, it can capsize. Therefore, Singapore is very careful. Don't allow religious and racial sentiments to surface. So high spending on national security may be viewed as a necessary evil, or more positively as an insurance plan. I take it as an insurance plan. Why we buy insurance plan? In case of an unexpected event. So, you know, this is something we have to continue to do. You know, in the case of Sri Lanka, until the LTTE war started, Sri Lankan military was, you know, former army commander is here, he knows the story. And, okay, third point. Politicians with high opportunity cost. This is something very familiar to us here in Sri Lanka. Should politics be a profession with zero opportunity cost? For non-economists, opportunity cost is, you know, the cost of what you have to forego. You know, if, you know, politics should not be a profession for people who have nothing else to do. Nothing, you know. So in that case, their opportunity cost is zero. Singapore said no to this. Lee Kuan Yew himself said this. Amazingly, throughout most of the contemporary Western world, leaders in government require no special training or qualification. Many get elected because they sound or look good on television. The results have been unhappy for their voters. So if you look at Singapore's cabinet, current cabinet or past cabinet, I think one of the most professional cabinets in the world. One, they are highly educated, you know, they all have at least a first degree, most of them have a master's degree, mostly from overseas universities, and they also have good military training because of compulsory military training in the national service, and current prime minister was a brigadier general of the army, so there are a number of other generals. So when a general election comes, people say it's election of generals. So it's a highly trained, and also cabinet is handpicked. Just to give you some examples, current Deputy Prime Minister, Tharman Shanmugaratnam, he has a Sri Lankan origin, very, very bright. He was the managing director of the central bank. Then he was nudged into politics. Contested the election, won, made the finance minister. Then the next managing director, Heng Swee Kiat, was also nudged into politics, made the finance minister. He is the current finance minister. Current managing director of the central bank, Ravi Menon, is another very bright chap. We think that he will also be nudged into politics. And current defense minister, Ng Eng Heng, was a very successful doctor, a surgeon, making millions of money. He was also nudged into politics. Like this, cabinet is basically picked from different. So see, that's the opportunity cost. See what they have to forego to take up this job? Huge. You know, they are not going into politics because now my career is over, therefore I'll do politics. So it is important because need foresight and vision to set the vision beyond a single term. And a very controversial issue here, highest paid ministers in the world. So if you know the numbers, you know they are getting paid. It's so huge. This was not at the time of Lee Kuan Yew. This happened at the time of Goh Chok Tong when he was the prime minister. But Lee Kuan Yew supported it without paying good money. These people don't give up their professions to join politics. Of course, we think that the politician should have a sense of sacrifice. That's important. But still, these people may not come to politics by giving up, you know, their, you know, prosperous careers. So Singapore is paying very good money to politicians, cabinet. Geopolitics. I thought this is very relevant to Sri Lanka-India situation. Now, Sri Lanka is so tiny in relation to India. So was Singapore. Singapore is a tiny Chinese fish in a big Malay Sea. You know, Malaysia on the one hand, Indonesia on the other. Now, I talked about bombing earlier. Indonesia, when Sukarno was the president, he did not like the Malaysian forming of the Malaysian Federation. So he instigated a lot of disruption in Singapore and Malaysia. And some bombings happened as a result. One famous bombing was the so-called McDonald House bombing. So this was a building which housed some banks. Some Indonesian Marines were sent, two of them, and they bombed the McDonald House, and it killed a number of people and also injured a lot of people. Building was crushed. But they were caught by Singapore. And subsequently, they were put to death and bodies were sent to Indonesia. Now, this created a huge uproar in Indonesia. Now, it's a big neighbor. What did Lee Kuan Yew do? He went to Indonesia. Not only went to Indonesia, he went to, at that time, Suharto has already come to power. Sukarno was, you know, overthrown. He went to Indonesia, went to the grave sites of these two guys and scattered flowers there. So this is called politics, you know. And after that, people were happy. Suharto and Lee Kuan Yew became lifelong friends. That's geopolitics. Now, ASEAN, Asian of Southeast Asian nations, play a very critical role. Initially, it was formed by five nations, Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Philippines, and Indonesia. Now, countries like Myanmar, Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, they also have joined. Now there are 10, initially five. One of the items in their manifesto is non-confrontational resolution of conflicts. So it plays a very, very critical role for Sri Lanka. SAARC should be the vehicle, to do this job. But Singapore kept its American alliance going. You know, America's presence in this region has been there for a long time, over 70 years, sort of the policeman in the region. But now China is, you know, center of gravity of the world economy is now shifting to Asia because of China's emergence. So now to align with China, but it all depends how America and China, you know, their relationship going to, you know, unfold. So a lot of people are saying, you know, stay, you know, neutral, but I think we can't stay neutral. We have to take a stand, you know. Neutral people always get crushed. So still we cannot ignore the geography. We cannot ignore the geography, you know, ASEAN. So in the case of Sri Lanka, we can't ignore India. But our politicians have to be very careful in handling the Indian situation. Okay. I'll quickly go through these. Key development strategies. Given Singapore's vulnerability and the lack of natural resources, policymakers gave priority to policies that promoted economic growth and quickly moved away from the British-style welfare state. This is something quite remarkable, you know. We continued with the British-style welfare system, whereas Singapore deviated from it. And I think the main reason, especially Goh Keng Swee I talk about, was responsible for this. I think main reason was the Confucian ethics. Confucian ethics. Thriftiness, you know, respect for elders, you know, self-responsibility, all this I think came from, I'm not sure, but I think it was the influence. Four areas: human resources, efficiency infrastructure, international competitiveness, development welfare. Now, development welfare as opposed to consumption welfare. Now, human resources, Singapore had targeted education, three phases, early industrialization phase, unemployment was very high, therefore they had antenatal policy, stop at two policy, you know, if you have more than two children, good luck, you know, they don't get tax benefits, nothing. But policy overshot, total fertility rate fell below the replacement level by 1975. And economy was expanding faster, therefore moved into pronatal policy, it is not working. Fertility rate is not going up. Actually, I completed a project for the government on exactly looking into this, what, you know, using confidential data. It's looking into cost of raising a child in Singapore. So submitted the report just recently. And then after the Asian financial crisis, you know, third phase. Now, this graph shows the university degrees holders in the labor force. It expanded as the demand for them expanded. This is what I wanted to emphasize. We should not expand the university education just for the sake of it. And I looked into Sri Lanka and Singapore. These are the enrollment in university degree courses percentages. When you look at Singapore, engineering takes up the lion's share. Sri Lanka engineering, 6.4%. You know, Sri Lanka still, you know, arts, 30%, still going to arts. See the huge contrast? These are average numbers over a number of years. Infrastructure. I use this term efficiency infrastructure to differentiate infrastructure. Now, high quality physical infrastructure supplemented by efficient service framework. Now, this is very important actually, because having a good infrastructure itself is not enough. You know, Singapore is a costly place now, but a ship, container ship coming to Singapore doesn't have to stay in Singapore for too long, can be cleared very quickly. Therefore, they still can economize on the cost side. Now, Thailand came up with Suvarnabhumi Airport because a plane coming from Europe touched down at Suvarnabhumi Airport, goes to, let's say, Australia and all that. It cuts the distance quite a lot. Did it succeed? No. Malaysia started a port called Tanjung Pelepas to compete with Singapore, this re-export economy. Did it succeed? No. It's the efficiency side of it. Now, we have Hambantota port, a very, very lucrative opportunity if we develop it well. But efficiency. Can the ships be diverted from Singapore to Hambantota? It all depends on the efficiency. Efficiency infrastructure. Then there is another innovation infrastructure legal framework. Upgrading of physical structures happens always in Singapore. In a way, I don't like it much. I call it reconstruction, not construction industry, reconstruction industry. Demolish and reconstruct, demolish and reconstruct. So environmental effects are there. So international competitiveness. Singapore usually get highly ranked in terms of competitiveness. Now, when you look at the cost competitiveness, Singapore uses two strategies. For short-term, cost-cutting measures are used. For long-term, productivity improvements. Now, for short-term cost-cutting, there is this wage flexibility institutionalized. This is something unique in Singapore. Typically, wages, you know, there is a huge resistance from labor unions when wages to be cut. So what Singapore did was to introduce a flexible component into wages. Every company has to have this flexible component, so the workers during a bad time expect this may be cut. Therefore, they don't have that mental block, oh, my salary was cut. So it's a wage flexibility institutionalized. And Central Provident Fund, this also cut when a recession happens. Now, development welfare. Singapore said no to Western-style consumption welfare. instead focused on development welfare to provide education, housing, healthcare, and other services at subsidized rates to Singaporeans. So that's called development welfare. Self and family responsibility. So this plays a key role. Self and family responsibility. So don't put the whole burden on the government, you know. So I had some slides on healthcare system. I took them off, took them out because it may take too much time. So they have what is called workfare instead of welfare. I know the story of Australia well, you know, because of the welfare payments, you know, a lot of especially migrants, new migrants to Australia, they live off social welfare so long, and they even make trips back to Sri Lanka just on welfare. They don't look for jobs. In Singapore, you get welfare payments only if you have a job. If the job doesn't pay you enough, we will give you supplements. That's the workfare system. Okay, so that's basically it, and some problems Singapore is facing. Of course, income inequality is one of the biggest challenges Singapore is currently facing. This is again that lifetime household labor income data by 9 deciles. You know, this is the lowest income decile and 9 deciles. You can see, by the way, this graph is a lot more informative than the Gini coefficient, the measure of income inequality. Gini coefficient just looks at income inequality cross-sectionally. This is the, you take the whole age income profile of a household over their working age. You look at, because over working age, your income profile will change. So as you can see, income inequality has increased so much. But when you think of income inequality, we also have to think of inequality versus unfairness. Unfairness. Usually, skill-based income inequality is unavoidable and usually not hated. You know, people don't hate so much income inequality. Do people hate, you know, Bill Gates or Steve Jobs or, you know, Mark Zuckerberg, you know, because these are all skill-based income inequality. It's the unfairness that is people cannot tolerate. So getting rich through unfair means. Singapore handled corruption by making the top non-corrupt. So this was one very big achievement of Singapore, you know, to get the country non-corrupt. Still, there is some corruption, but they're handled very seriously. Some other issues, people are demanding more social welfare. An aging population is a big issue because the falling fertility rate. Labor shortage, now going for automation, you know. Now in National University of Singapore, in the canteen, we have to use that QR codes to pay off, you know, pay the bills. It's going to go completely cashless now, you know, automation. Growing competition and strategies for the next lap. So country is seriously looking into what strategies for the next lap. That's it.
Thank you, Tilak. Thank you very much. A lot of food for thought. Some of it very frightening. I will not talk about it now. I will call upon Dr. Dushni Veerakon, Director of the Institute of Policy Studies, to address you. After that, we'll see how much time we have to have a general discourse. Dushni.
Thank you, Dr. Fernando, and thank you, Tilak, for that very detailed and exhaustive look at the Singapore experience of economic development. I don't claim to be an expert, and I think Tilak has the advantage of having actually lived there for decades. The only time that I looked at the Singapore experience was when the whole issue of the East Asian miracle, the newly industrializing economies got a head start. That debate was ongoing, but I haven't looked at the details of Singapore more recently. But if you ask any Singaporean, I think, about what were the main ingredients of their success, it struck me that three things come up, and Tilak has in many ways referred to those three. One is that its strategic location at the mouth of the Malacca Straits where nearly 40% of the maritime shipping passes through. The second is that Singapore adopted the economic policies, opening up to trade and investment at the appropriate time, and more specifically, that it was very successful in getting multinational corporations to come and set up their headquarters in Singapore. And the third factor, which again Tilak emphasized, is the quality of its government. Government is small, efficient, and honest. And that, I think, has also been one of the key successes, not only of Singapore, but also comparatively of some of the other Southeast Asian, East Asian economies. Now, on their own, these three strands really don't work. You may be strategically located, but if you don't take advantage of that, that doesn't translate into any economic gains. To me, and this is coming from the time that decades ago when we looked at the East Asian experience, it is that Singapore, and I think it is the quality of its technocracy, that they were able to be very agile, identify changes in the international economic landscape, change course. And there are three distinct phases of economic policy that Singapore underwent. First, from independence to mid-80s. As I said earlier, they opened up to trade and investment when most developing countries like Sri Lanka chose instead to turn our backs on integrating with the rest of the world and looked inwards. In the mid-80s, Singapore went through its first recession or contraction. I think the graph that Tilak put up on the screen, where they changed direction to look at deregulation and structural reforms to look at modern services sector as the driver of their growth. So you had twin drivers, manufacturing and modern services sector. Singapore deregulated telecommunications, financial services, and so many other sectors. And the third phase is the post-global financial crisis. Singapore is rapidly aging. It has a huge immigrant worker population that is now generating a backlash. So the third phase is that they are looking at productivity as the main driver of growth through innovation. And I'm sure, given Singapore's past record, they'd be as successful in making that transition. Now, my main problem whenever this Singapore experience comes up is when lessons are being drawn for Sri Lanka. Earlier in the day, I mean, I was just sitting next to Dr. Rajpathirana, and we said, what are the areas of comparison in terms of resource endowments, in terms of size, in terms of the economic structures? Singapore essentially is a city-state. It has a different, it has no rural agricultural sector. Its political governance structures are different. Political party systems are different. And with all those more differences and complementarities, when we generally try to draw lessons, I mean, we take Singapore as a model on which Sri Lanka is sort of, you know, restructuring itself. It's a bit of a puzzle to me, because Singapore is, I think, the only richest country in the world that has not seen a change in its ruling party since 1965, the first time that the People's Action Party got in. Oh, sorry, it was in 1959. The first time an opposition MP was elected into the Singapore Party or a parliament was 1981. Now, the different models of the East Asian benevolent dictatorship or benevolent, what's the other word? Versus the kind of fragmented democracies that we have in South Asia. So much has been researched about why one system appears to deliver better returns than the other. The evidence suggests that no one system is better than the other, because if you take a mix of Latin American countries and African countries that also had dictatorships, some of it benevolent, they made a mess of their economic development. So the success stories are very much located in the East Asian and Southeast Asian region, and it's not something that is easily replicable for a country like Sri Lanka that has a two-party dominated democracy, change of party every 5 years, alternative economic policies that are being pursued. So the whole, the first of the four things that Tilak identified, political stability and quality of governance, to me, I see no areas in which we can compare ourselves or hope to replicate Singapore's success. The second and last point I want to also touch on is the issue of, to some extent, the welfare state and the populism that comes with the kind of institutional and political structures that we have. Singapore was able to discontinue the welfare policies of its what it inherited from the British, largely because they didn't have a rural agrarian dependent population. Singapore did have a de facto welfare policy in terms of the subsidized public housing that it provided. Nearly 80% of the Singaporean population now owns their own homes. There is no slums, there is no homelessness in that country. But Singapore did have some degree of de facto welfare state in its makeup. The second issue and the final point that Tilak stopped at on inequality, Singapore has one of the highest levels of inequality in the world, and that's by Gini coefficient. I know there are problems in Gini, but if you're looking at international comparative comparisons, Singapore does stand out. That is because it has a tax system that is highly regressive. It has no capital gains tax, no inheritance tax, very low income tax rates. Now again, the limited welfare and their ability to generally overlook rising and high income inequality are things that in this country we will never, politicians or in any democratic political structures, is not likely to be possible. So, I mean, I enjoyed listening to Tilak. I think there's lots for us to learn from Singapore and its experiences. But when we attempt to draw lessons at the very broad level, there are micro lessons to be learned, but at the broader level, I'm always puzzled when Singapore is held up as an example for us here in Sri Lanka. I wish it could be otherwise, but I'm skeptical on how much of it can be replicated here. I'm going to stop at that, Dr. Fernando.
Thank you, Dushni.
Something I wanted to say, but I forgot to mention, is that Singapore worked out its own unique model. Of course, learn from others. I'm sure, you know, from the remarks Lee Kuan Yew made from time to time, must have learned from Sri Lanka's failure too. But it worked out its own unique model. We cannot transplant that model elsewhere. So Sri Lanka has to learn from others, but we have to work out our own unique model.
Yeah, I agree.
Thank you very much. With your permission, see, I would like to spend another half an hour and open the floor for discussion. But before that, Nimal, would you like to say something?
No. Let the audience.
Okay. So let's keep it short. So that I could give each person a chance to speak, say 5 minutes each. We have a microphone there because I'm very short of hearing and would like you to speak to the microphone. Can you bring it? Can you put up your hand, please, so that I will know how many would like to speak?
Thank you for that interesting presentation. The lessons I think I would possibly see from Singapore would be sound macroeconomic policies, balanced budgets, low levels of debt, rule of law, sound central banking with no inflationary financing of the deficit. So those good macro policies allied with the openness to trade are probably the lessons that we can draw. Directed government would depend on the level of governance. It was heavy interventionist in Singapore, but to replicate that without a very technocratic, very highly capable set of bureaucrats and government, I think in any other setting would be very difficult.
Thank you. Who's next?
Thank you very much for the very illuminating talk. We learned a lot. But there's one question that I have is, basically the macroeconomic framework has to be right for anything to happen. There's one question I have is, how much, could you give us some insights on the role of human capital in the development of Singapore? And did the government have any direct influence or influence on promoting science and technology and the associated engineering subjects to make certain things happen? So that is something that I would like to get some feedback on.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. You have said several reasons for developing the development of Singapore, but I like to know, after 70 years of independence, our country, what is the main reason that is blocking us from developing like Singapore? There are several reasons you have said about Singapore, but what is the main reason, one and the main reason that is blocking us from developing like Singapore? Thank
you. Professor, you didn't emphasize too much on the foreign direct investments into Singapore. It's one of the leading countries attracting foreign direct investment as the basis for development, production, and so on, industrialization. You didn't emphasize too much. And the second related question is, why do you think that foreign direct investments are avoiding Sri Lanka?
Okay. Any other?
Thank you. Thank you very much for the lovely, very entertaining and very informative lecture. One quick question. I think you did not emphasize much on the dictatorial powers he used, which I think is greatly needed in this country, because we have been democratic, and one failure in our system is lack of that dedication by the rulers to do what they want, good stuff. For some reason we have failed, right? Because we want to be democratic. We want to be democratic. But democracy is good for the wrong purposes in this country, okay? So a little bit of totalitarianism, as somebody said in the past, right? We need it. But do we have the correct person? The country should choose it. But can you please explain how Lee Kuan used dictatorial, so-called dictatorial powers, right? And to protect what? That's the question I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. I think you made a very important point, because normally a very qualified, highly trained economist, they don't talk about it. That is the non-economic factors that is crucial in economic development. I think time has come to change our whole understanding of economics with this concept. In Sri Lanka, in our understanding, the so many non-economic factors have contributed to our whole running down of our economy. To mention few, I mean, you know these things. You know the issue of religion, how much we have taken the religion so seriously. Secondly, language, ethnicity. These are the issues that has ruined our economy over the years from the time of independence. Unless we address these issues, I don't think we can't imagine becoming a Singapore or any country in the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor, for that very educational lecture. Just to follow up on what he said, most of the economists, like you said, they don't use real world factors into implementing their views on development of something like Sri Lanka. And in your opinion, what are the top three factors we could use to realistically implement to develop Sri Lanka in the form of Singapore? Realistic factors. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Now I think I'll give the floor to Prof. Tilak.
So many questions. I'll pick and choose. Okay, I don't want to be prescriptive here, but I'll state the facts just as they are. Now, talking about dictatorial system, Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew, I think probably he had the vision, because what he did first was to consolidate power. He did not throw away the democracy, kept it there, but consolidated power in his hand and weakened the opposition as much as he could. So when a general election is held, most of the ruling party members just walk in. There was no contest. So that's the thing that he did. I think probably through his vision, he knew without that stability, because Singapore started at a very vulnerable point. Without that power, they cannot do much. So he was not a dictator. People didn't have to go into a revolution to throw away the dictator. Elections were held regularly, but he weakened the opposition. Also weakened the labor unions. Now, should Sri Lanka have a dictatorial system? I don't think it's necessary, but we need a determined leader to be kept at least 15 years. That's my thinking. I really don't like our constitution that limits the term of the president just to two terms. Because when that was designed, my thinking is that was designed by looking at the bad side of it. If a bad guy stays in power for too long, but how about the other side? If a good guy is there, can we keep him long enough? You know, so if he can keep a determined leader for 15 years, probably we get the political stability. And as for quality of governance, as I said, leave the economy in the hands of the private sector. Of course, there's a lot the government has to do. Infrastructure development, private sector doesn't do that. But in general, leave the economy in the hands of the private sector. they will do the job. Government provides the macroeconomic environment. Then the country will come off. Politicals, now, related to this, why FDI? No? Not coming to Sri Lanka. Simple. Why FDI is going to Vietnam? Why is it going to China? Political stability. Political stability. There is no uncertainty. Now, in Sri Lanka, there is so much uncertainty, that's why FDI is not coming to Sri Lanka. So political stability plays a very, very important role, actually. It's a question of when we find the right leader, just support him. You know? Quite often, it is the internal strife that toppled the government. This happened in Australia. Kevin Rudd was a very popular leader, but he's next in charge, you know, because of internal politics within the party, became the next prime minister. So, as for, I'll leave it to you. And talking about the economic policies, actually I was focusing on the macroeconomic environment. There are a lot of policies that Singapore has implemented, probably which are very instructive, like for example, racial mixing. You know, as I said, you know, Raffles, you know, segregated, you know, Malays here, Chinese are there, and so on. Now there is a policy in Singapore government, government housing blocks, you know, you cannot have, there's a quota. You know, if the apartment is owned by a Chinese, is going to sell to a Malay, they check the quota, whether the Malay quota is full or not. So just, I mean, this, some people blame this social engineering, but Singapore does these things. I mean, there are a lot of things that you can criticize about Singapore. Singaporeans do this, critical of Singapore, but these policies are there. My focus was mainly on to focus on the macroeconomic environment, what we have to do, and let the private sector do the job. How do we set that environment for the private sector to do the job? And I'm happy, you know, young people are there, you know, they are the people who are going to be in charge of the country, you know, after we are gone. And so taking these matters very seriously into their account. Top three factors, I gave four factors, four non-economic variables that we should focus on. So there are so many other things that we can focus on, but I think they are more micromanagement. You know, macroeconomic policies, all these are more micromanagement. Each country has to do their own stuff. But in general, what are the key factors? Human capital. That's the key factor. Singapore has no other resources except for the strategic location. And invest so much on human capital. Singapore doesn't have enough skilled labor, so they have this thing called foreign talent. You know, immigration, in-migration, foreign talent. So if you take my department at the National University of Singapore, the number of Singaporeans, very few. The rest is all foreign. So Singapore has to be, this is, human capital matters a lot. So that's why the university degree holding population has gone up so much. So invest quite a lot on that.
Okay, thank you, Tilak. And also thank you, Dushi. I'm not going to take more than 3 minutes to wind up. Tilak mentioned a very important thing. Singapore is not a model for us. There is no model for Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka must adopt its own model. But there are lessons to be learnt. You remember, before introducing Dushni, I said, listening to Tilak, I felt very frightened. Do we have those ingredients to make this country go forward? The most important thing is that Singapore is run by a technocracy. The people there, you see, starting with the cabinet of ministers, the bureaucracy, and then the ordinary folk, they're all highly disciplined. You see, the most important, you did not mention the fact that the Singaporeans are very disciplined people. See? And we don't have that. Look at the way we behave on the streets. Look at the way the cars are run. the motorcycles come in, the three-wheelers come in, everybody trying to rush in, get in there, not leaving the others. Now that culture has to change. It's the same thing with the politicians. Everybody trying to rush in somewhere. The politicians are generally very myopic, but not in Singapore. Singapore, they have a long-term vision. You said that these are technocrats who have come in. Some people were nudged into politics. You see, by that time they had acquired so much of knowledge, you see, skills. And that's how they were able to manage it. And that helped them to develop a vision. The most important thing is a vision. A vision which has to be translated into action through plans and programs. That vision has to be a collective vision. That's another important thing. It's not just coming from like Mao's thoughts, you see, one single person's ideas. So Singapore was able to do that. And this is something to be learned. And that came from the fact that the people who got around to run the country for all very professional people. So discipline, vision, and the role of the private sector was mentioned. Now we are used to saying that the private sector is the engine of growth, but the engine driver is the government. Engine driver doesn't mean that you try to control, but you try to facilitate. Now that is the role of the government. According to the government develops a vision and gets the engine to move in that direction, the right direction. So I wouldn't like to take more time. Having said that, and I said frightening because we don't have those ingredients. Discipline is not there, the technocracy is not there, no vision. And one important thing also he mentioned, equity. You see, equity is not equality, it is equal opportunity. And that's fundamental. That's how people go up. And then also, you talked of human resources. You saw the chart, how the education system is charted. You see, so this is the thing. You know, we have so many graduates coming out of the art stream, and they have no jobs. Now, there are 60,000 graduates. See, I think they demonstrated yesterday and today also. You see, asking for jobs. They think the government owes them a living. Of course, you can't blame them. Also because it's poor education. They don't fit in anywhere. And then I hear a very important politician saying, we will give them jobs, some or other, 60,000 jobs. So we have some advisors here, economic advisors. I don't know how they're going to find the wherewithal to accommodate 60,000 jobs for graduates. Anyway, I will not want to go further. I mean, you have stimulated a lot of thought. You see, very interesting. These are matters which should be studied in depth. And then I think we should have more and more discussions of this sort in order to find our way through. Thank you very much for coming, and thank you very much, Tilak, Tushni. And the chairman kept quiet, and still I'm sure he will have a lot of things to say. So thank you very much for coming. Good night.